Okay.
I push the record button. I have, looks like it's recording. Okay. And here we go. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 397. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and today we're going to talk about hamstudy.org. So before we do that, need to apologize. I know it's been about 3 weeks. Life gets in the way. I've not got up a show. I will tell you that on the heels of this show, by the end of the week or early next week, there will be another one. I may hold it back a little bit. But content is coming. And thank you for asking. So I am going to jump right into it. I'd like to introduce you to, actually, I'm going to put you up here full screen. Richard Bateman, Kilo Delta 7, Bravo, Bravo, Charlie. He is the owner, one of the authors of hamstudy.org. Hi, Richard. Thank you for joining me today.
Hi, David. Glad to be here.
Excellent, excellent. So I asked you to come on because I've actually used your product, and I have one of your antennas, but I looked around and couldn't find it. And I think it was a great thing to bring to the audience. A number of the folks in our area highly, highly recommend when they talk about the different products to use to study, either to get your ticket initially or one of the other ones. Yours is one that always comes up. And so I thought I'd just invite you on to kind of talk about it.
Well, I'm always happy to talk about ham study and what we do and why we do it.
So how long has this been an offering?
So that's a little bit of a complicated question to ask because it depends on how you want to, where you want to define the beginnings. You could say I come by this hobby, honestly. My grandfather was licensed in 1948 and my father in 1976. So my family has been into ham radio for a long time. And, I was frustrated when I studied for my exam 20 years ago with the fact that all of the technology, if you want to call it that, for studying for the test basically amounted to practice exams and books. And that bothered me for a long time, and I did a lot of different little things. So I've had some kind of different tools that I've put together that have been used by small groups of people. But hamstudy.org as a website on hamstudy.org, I think, has been there for about 8 years. But it did initially look very, very different than it does now. I think we've pretty much completely rewritten it 3 times. And if you count the new mobile app we just released, that'll be the 4th time. And that will be migrating onto the website. It's just not there yet. So it's gone through a lot of different iterations. It's gone through a lot of different views. In fact, at one point it was just practice tests with a little bit better history than the other websites at the time. But I've been tinkering with this stuff for probably about 8 to 12 years, depending on how you want to measure things.
And when you first launched it about 8 years ago, did you just start with Technician, or did you put it all together and launch, you know, all the levels at the same time?
So the earliest tools that I really did is I was just frustrated with the fact that all I wanted to do was be able to read the questions as I was finishing my preparation for my general exam. And so I wrote a PHP script, because that was the language I was using at the time, that just parsed through the text question pool and converted it to XML format. And once I had that written, it wasn't too hard to get it working on all 3 pools. And so I had all of those in an XML format. And that was actually probably more like 14 or 15 years ago. And so when I then created the earliest versions of the actual application, I already had all of that in that format. I just converted it into a JSON format. It was a little easier to pull into my software. And when we first started, we had all of the pools. We didn't have any explanations or anything like that back then, and we didn't have the flashcards. It was just, you know, practice tests and a way of easily reading questions. But it's always made the most sense to me that the pools are all open. Let's just pull them all in and get going. Mm-hmm.
And so you said initially it didn't have all of the explanations. When you put it up there and posted it, was that an early goal, or was that something that kind of came along over time? You realized, hey, maybe it would help to put a little bit more information and do the explanations.
That's actually really hard to remember exactly at what point I decided that I thought that was a good idea. So one piece of the puzzle is that I've been an active VE for the local test session for probably about 14 or 15 years, I think. It's really hard to remember the specifics on some of that. Mm-hmm. But we've had the same VE, Steve Whitehead, NV7V, who's run the local Utah County test session for as long as anyone around here can remember. He gave me my first exams, and so eventually I started helping out with his test session. And it was really through watching both his test session, watching applicants coming through that and seeing how they responded, and seeing the things that they missed and the frustration. One thing I used to hear a lot was a frustration that, well, I haven't seen all of the questions. I've been taking practice tests for weeks, and I haven't seen all of the questions. And a lot of the sites back then actually didn't have all of the questions on them, I don't think. They only had a fixed number of practice exams that you could take. I'm not 100% certain of that, but it certainly seemed to be the case, because most people who came through had not seen any all of that. And a lot of those sites have really improved since then. But so initially I was just trying to get something to help people be able to find all of that. And as I went, I just looked for what those people seemed to need. And he's been doing a ham cram kind of a 1 day class for about 15 years. And so I was also looking for, well, how can we best help these people prepare for the exam and learn as much as possible while doing it? Obviously, with a ham cram, you're not going to get the full understanding of everything that you would with a longer, more in-depth class. But we've actually found in this area, we have a lot higher retention, a lot more people entering the hobby since we've started doing that. And so it was kind of that back and forth of trying to do that that just kind of prompted all of the different features. And so I had this crazy idea that, well, I don't have time to write all of the questions. And frankly, I'm a much better software developer than I am electrical engineer. And so while I've got my amateur extra, I didn't really feel qualified to answer all of those questions. But I thought, you know, if we can just set it up so that people are able to help with that, then eventually people, we'll be able to get all of them. And I had a lot of people tell me that I was crazy for doing that. Why would you just let people put whatever they want on your site? You're going to have problems with spam. You're going to have problems with just really crap explanations. And, I think people underestimate other people's desire to help and do good, especially in ham radio sometimes. I mean, I've met some people in ham radio that seemed a little less focused on the good of people around them than others. But by and large, I mean, I think I've only ever had one actual issue with explanations on ham study. If you don't count once or twice when somebody's, 5-year-old child got on and accidentally changed some things and stuff like that. So it's been a lot of fun. It's been really interesting to watch. We've actually only had full explanations on everything, I think, for about 2 years. Two to three years ago is when we finally got the rest of the amateur extra pool, which was the last one that we got, that we finally hit 100% for explanations on.
When you turn that feature on to allow people to start going in there and making comments, how long do you think did it take to kind of flush out, get, most of or all of the answers in there? Was it pretty quick or did it take a while?
Well, I mean, you have to realize that Ham Study has had... Anytime you introduce a completely new product into any industry, it can take a while for momentum to grow. Yeah. Ham radio, in my experience, is about 10 times as much as any other industry that I've worked with. Mm-hmm. And the company that I work for is called GradeCam, and we work in the education industry. So that should tell you just how slow that can be. And the problem is often it's two things. One, it's most people tend to learn from a mentor or an Elmer, if you want to use that term. Mm-hmm. And the Elmer got their license 20 years ago. They took their practice tests online and they studied using a book and practice tests. And that was the way they did it. And it was good enough for me then. It's good enough now. Why should I look for anything different? A lot of people don't look for anything different. Mm-hmm. And so it's been really interesting to watch the gradual growth of the website. So when I first turned it on, we had about, I want to say 50 to 100 unique visits per month. And so, yeah, I don't feel like I think we first turned it on with, it was still the 2006 technician pool. And we got a few in general and one or two in extra, and we got maybe 30% into the technician pool before it changed in 2010. And so I actually had to write a system that would go through, that would, and it requires a lot of human intervention to analyze the pools and track, okay, this is where the old question, this old question maps to this new question. Sometimes they're in the same place. Sometimes they've moved in the section. Sometimes they've moved to a totally different sub-element even. And so for each pool, I actually had to write a mapping that maps from, this is where the old question is. This is where the new question is. These are the questions that have just been reworded. These are the questions that are new. These are the questions that were removed. And then once I'd done that, I could just run a second script that would say, okay, now that we know that, let's just copy all of the explanations forward so that we can still keep going with these. But it was actually our old layout. And if you look on, I think there's still on YouTube somewhere, there's some videos with walkthroughs on the old ham study system. And it was the type that can give you interface poisoning. If you've ever read that, there's an old Dilbert cartoon where Alice gets interface poisoning. She was exposed to a UI designed by an engineer, and the doctor tells her that she's got about a week to live. It was done by me, and it was pretty bad. Yeah. It took a long time. It took a long time to do that. Conversely, the new technician pool that goes live this year was announced sometime in January, I believe. The last errata is February 12th. So by the time that last errata hit, we had, there was, I believe, somewhere around 80 new questions, and we had explanations for all of them already, even though all of those explanations just came from, you know, I pulled it into the system, so you've been able to access it if you knew the URL for a while, but I don't make it visible until about 2 months before. So it became visible on May 1st. And it's visible now, and we have all the explanations, even though there's 80 new questions. And that's just because I posted in a couple places and I said, hey guys, we've got 80 new questions we need explanations for. Who's willing to help? And it took about 2 weeks and we had everything. So it's a big difference then versus now. It took probably 4 or 5 years before we actually hit 100% on all three pools, maybe more. It's hard to remember the exact years on everything. But now that we're there, keeping it there so far has been much easier. I mean, we'll see how I expect the general pool will be a little harder and the extra pool may be a lot harder. And of course, if the question pool committee decides to make really major changes, it's all going to depend on how many new questions there are. But 80 new explanations in under 2 weeks before the pool was even generally visible. I was just amazed and grateful because it's a great service to the community that people are just willing to do.
So it does sound like there's a big community that follows along, and I'll assume that, you know, it's not technicians in there, but it's probably, you know, generals and extra that are just trying to help out to make sure that it's up to date and it works out.
I think you've got people from all walks. Some of the people who particularly helped out, I know were people who teach classes. I mean, some of them I knew, some of them I didn't. I watch everything as it comes by so I can verify that there aren't any problems being introduced. But a lot of times they're not people I know. But there's the amateur radio subreddit. The people on there have just been absolutely great, and they've been a big support in areas like that. We've got a Facebook page, and I think it was mostly between those two places is where most of that help came in. And I know that there are other groups out there, but those are kind of the two that I use most myself, that I've just found most welcoming to the way that I try to do things and seem to spend most of my time on. So
that's great. So you talked about your local VE. So do they when they set students up and they do their 1 day class, they tell them ahead of time to get on the site here and run through the pool, you know, so that they have something before they come in? Or they give them the questions and answers and just ask them to read it? I know how we do it here, but I always wonder how each different, you know, 1 day class works.
So the man who runs that, and this is kind of an amusing aside, is now my father-in-law. I married his daughter 10 years ago. I had already been close friends with him for quite a number of years before that. So that was a little strange to actually date one of your friend's daughters. But he runs the class. Mm-hmm. And I know he sends out an email ahead of time, which is kind of long, and I don't know that I've read it in a long time. I believe that he does mention different resources, and I think he recommends Dave Kassler's videos. He recommends ham study for running through things. But most of the studying, I think, actually takes place after they get there. So he's just worked through, I think he's using Norm Goodkin's PDFs or maybe a modification of those.
Mm-hmm. Norm Goodkin is, he's my Elmer. He lives about three blocks away.
He's a good man. I really like Norm. I've actually met Norm once while I was out there in California. Mm-hmm. Because I work for a company that's based out of California. So I used to get out there periodically. So I think he's using Norm's old PDFs. And he just basically, it's kind of a summary of here's all of the stuff that you need to know in the pool. It's not an in-depth summary. But he goes through that. He starts at about 7:30 in the morning. He finishes around 12:30. And he starts out and basically says, now I'm just going to have to tell you that during this, we don't have time for questions. Mm-hmm. Don't raise your hand. Don't ask questions. We're just going to go through this. And he'll talk and he'll hit every topic. He'll go into a little more detail on ones that he knows are people have more trouble with. Mm-hmm. And then we'll break for lunch for an hour and we'll come back and we'll start the test session. Usually we go into a different room and we'll have the other VEs. He'll stay in there with the class with maybe one or two other people who have some experience teaching, and the rest of us will go out over into the other room and we'll run the test session, and they'll just filter over as they're ready from about 2:30 to 5 or 5:30. And most months we have somewhere between 20 and 40 people pass that, pass the exam there. So ours is actually a pretty big exam session. We have two exam sessions every month. Third Wednesday of the month and usually the third Saturday of the month during the school year. He doesn't do the class during the summer. Mm-hmm. And we probably run an average of anywhere from 25 to 50 applicants per month. And so that's been one of the biggest helps for ham study, is because it was working with those groups and watching those teams. And so I'd see what tools they were using, and they used to use other ones before I really got ham study working with the explanations and the new flashcards and everything. And so I'd watch how they were studying and where they were struggling and what things seemed to be working well. And there's been a few features that I added to ham study that I then later ended up taking out because I found that working with that group, I found they were actually harmful. A statistic that I figured out recently, I was starting to do some analysis on the question pools. And one of my big things is it frustrates me how almost everybody wants to do practice exams. Like, I mean, practice exams are great. Great. Don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. But everyone seems, there's like this mass understanding or perspective that the way that you pass the ham radio exam is you keep taking practice exams until you're passing. I'm not saying that that's inherently wrong, but let me give you a statistic. On the current question pool, it takes an average of 80 random practice exams to see every question on the pool at least once. Now, that's an average. So using cryptographically secure random stuff, I built a simulation and I ran it on 10,000 different, random simulated applicants. And I didn't try to answer any of the questions. I just said, okay, we'll use the rules to generate random exams. And for each of these applicants, 10,000 different ones, I kept giving them random exams, kept generating random exams until every question had been seen once. Mm-hmm. And the minimum that I ever saw out of 10,000 was something like 41, and the maximum was 230-something. I don't remember the exact numbers. I have them written down somewhere if anybody actually cares for some reason that I can't fathom. But the average is about 80. And on the general and extra, of course, it's much worse. It's like 91 and 106. That is ridiculously inefficient, because in that time, some of those things you've seen potentially on every, theoretically possible, you may have seen on almost every exam. And so what I was trying to do is I wanted to make that more efficient. And so we came up with the flashcards, and the flashcards are great. They're actually called study mode in the new app because so many people would never try them. Okay. They saw flashcards. They're like, oh, I don't want to do flashcards. I want to take practice exams. So we renamed it study mode. And I'm hoping that that will help people to actually give it a try and realize, oh, hey, this is actually fun. This is actually helpful. But I tried to do it where I used the same selection algorithm with what I called a smart exam that I used when I picked flashcard decks, which is basically that, and I've actually changed it over time, but at the time, basically it was, let's take what we see as being the hardest question, which is the one that you've either not seen or that you haven't answered correctly, mm-hmm. or, you know, I've got kind of an algorithm for figuring out what's probably basically the hardest question for you, given the data that we have. And the problem with that is if you use that algorithm, you can see every question in the pool in 14 exams, which is great. But how many people do you know who can take 14 exams in a row and fail and not get discouraged?
Right.
And so we'd have these people who were taking practice exams. And there was one time, there was a lady almost in tears because she'd been taking practice exams for like an hour. And I think she'd taken 6 or 7 exams. And she's like, I'm not getting any better. Mm-hmm. And that's the point where I realized, yeah, you're not, because you're not reviewing anything. You're not seeing anything again. You're just seeing the same, you know, you're just continuing to see new things. I mean, we've optimized this to make you feel miserable. Mm-hmm. And so that's where I took that out. And that was an interesting learning experience. And we kind of applied that with some other research that we'd found that the most learning happens not when things are easy and not when things are too hard, but when you find that middle point where things are difficult enough to keep you interested, but not so hard that you get frustrated. And that is actually the secret behind, don't tell anyone, that's the secret behind the HAM study algorithm, uh-huh. is that it optimizes for your frustration level. It optimizes so that when things are getting really difficult, it will give you easier questions. And when things are too easy, it gives you harder questions, which coincidentally happens to look almost exactly a lot the same as spaced repetition algorithms do.
And is that based on the easy and hard is based on previous examples? So people run through the test and the easy ones, everybody gets right, and the hard ones, fewer people get right?
No, I've done experiments with that. And for a while, that was how we were doing it. In fact, I think some parts of the current online HAM study are doing that as well. What I found is that there's so much variance between, and it's almost embarrassing how much time I've spent on this, because I mean I have something like 15 million flashcard answers in our database that I can analyze. I mean it's not like I can't personally identify this to every individual person or anything like that, but I can take it and I can look at patterns in aggregate. And what I found is that there's so much variance in experience that there's relatively few questions that you can really categoristically say, oh, this is the hardest question in the pool. It's like, well, this is the hardest question in the pool for people with this background, and this one is for people with this background. And it depends so much on your background. You know, you have somebody come in who's an electrical engineer and stuff that's just completely unfathomable on the extra exam to a housewife is like, oh, well, that makes perfect sense. No problem at all. Whereas the housewife may, if she has no math background, she may either require months of math background, or she may just have to memorize the question. Mm-hmm. And I see that range. I see 8-year-old kids. I see, yeah, I mean, we've just got all around the whole spectrum of people using the system, and we really have a very wide range in our class, and so that's been helpful to see one-on-one, you know, how people see that. And so what we finally ended up deciding is that the most efficient way of doing it is actually not to try to guess based on other people's experience, is just to solely tie it down to what your experience is. And so that's, you know, when you take practice exams on HAM study, it actually takes that data and feeds it into the study mode. You know, and every time, everything you go through on the study mode. With the new app that we just released, there's a cram mode, and this will be coming to the website. I just have to find time to finish adapting it. We've been scrambling on things left and right for months now, really. My kids want to see me again someday. But so there's a new cram mode that I'm hoping will be helpful as kind of an intermediate step between just reading questions and studying the questions. Because a lot of people find it frustrating if the first time they see the question is being quizzed to them. They want to just see, okay, help me see the question. Let me read the explanation for the question. And I want to go through that before I get quizzed on it. And so the cram mode, you can do that, and then you mark on a 1 to 7 scale how difficult that question is for you. And then it captures that information and feeds that into the flashcards. And then the flashcard, you know, the study mode, the cram, quiz mode is what it's called. So the cram mode for where you just set the difficulty, then you switch back to cram mode, or to quiz mode, and it's able to actually utilize that that information that's just gathered to help know, well, what's harder, what's easier, so it can kind of do that. But the this is another trade secret, don't tell anyone. The basic difficulty is hardest is something you haven't seen. Next hardest is something that you've never answered correctly. And then after that, it's kind of a logarithmic scale based on the last 10 times that you saw the question that it grades at. And it basically just evaluates everything on what levels that is. And then when it picks questions, it uses that to determine where to pick the questions from.
Yeah, and it's so interesting the different approaches to this. You know, I've been a ham for since about 2011, and I sat in one of Norman and his wife Naomi's one day classes. And you know, they send you the pool ahead of time, and they say, read through these at least twice, you know, and try to retain what you can, and then they go through the questions basically with you, and mostly it's you read it on your own, and they give you a break every 45 minutes, and they talk through a section. So here's safety, and here's some electronics, and here's how the schematics work, and here's how this part works. And at the end of the day, you know, same thing, you take the test, and they do pretty well, a 90 plus 95% pass rate pretty consistently, and they do quarterly classes. And shortly after that, I thought, oh, I'll do my general. And then that was like 2012. And I did. I started out, I don't know, I think it was yours. I'm not sure it was yours or one of the other ones. And I started out online, and I had a similar experience to what you said. I'd get in there, and I got some of it, but I didn't get other parts of it. And for me, I'm not a test taker. So it was very frustrating. I'd get it wrong. Or I'd consistently go in there, and I'd be like 50%. Sometimes it'd be 60%, sometimes it'd be 40%. And again, I think it's based on which random set of questions are presented to you and how much mastery you had. And that was, at the time I took it, it was right before the pool changed. And so Naomi was, you know, she's a awesome cheerleader and getting this gone and moving it forward. And she said, oh, you know, it's going to change, and here's the day. And the day before, we're going to have a test session. You know, do what you can. And I remember, I can picture myself in the backyard, sitting by the pool, kids in the pool with me and my list, reading question. And I went and I took it, and I didn't pass by a lot, but, you know, passing a lot. It's all, you know, I'm still a general now.
Right.
And I, you know, I'd hear from other people, or I go see the way other classes work, and they're like, oh, you know, just studying for the thing and getting it done isn't the right way to do it. You need to understand it all. And I, you know, I'm troubled with all of that. And I wonder what your perspective is. It's like, to me, getting your technician's license is the key to learning the stuff that you need to do radio, to be a ham. And probably most of our, I don't want to say customers, but most of the students that we have through, they want to do cert, or they are they're backpackers, or they're off-roaders, or, you know, it's actually really few of them that are real, you know, electronic engineers and want to go make stuff, build stuff, take stuff apart, understand all the bits and pieces. And I think it's different depending on what that audience is, as to what level of mastery you need. And, you know, I often think of myself, you know, I did a lot of electronics in high school, but not a ton of it. I'm a computer engineer, so I get more bits and pieces about that. And I wonder, like, am I, could I be an extra? Because I don't understand some of it. I understand most of it. And, you know, where do we fall in that line? And someday, I keep telling myself, someday I'll make it. And I've gone through and I picked it back up and in a little bit, I'll show you the iPad app that you sent me a link for. My daughter gushed about how awesome the flashcards were because I put it in front of her. She's a tech and she wants to be mm-hmm. general. She's like, oh, the UI is awesome. And this is awesome. But going back to the what's the right level, how does that kind of lie with you? What's your thoughts in terms of like, how much do you need to know or not know? And where does it go? You know,
that's a question that however I answer it, somebody's going to judge me for, you know, but which I'm actually fine with. when I decided to really do this seriously, and I'm not even certain I can tell you exactly when that was. I mean, my thing is technology. I'm a technologist. I write computer software for a living. But you know, I work now for a company called Greycam. I didn't when I started it, but it's interesting because about half of our development team are hams, including the CEO. And for a while, all of us were hams, and that was just, you know, kind of a coincidental thing. And we're all technologists. We're all software developers, but we work on a product that allows teachers to integrate the way that they're already doing things with our technology in a way that doesn't require them to stop doing what they're doing. They don't have to have a device for every desk. They don't have to have everything, you know, they don't have to totally change the way that they do everything. We have a technology that allows you to scan bubble answer sheets using a webcam. I've actually created a tool called Exam Tools that you can use for administering ham radio exams using that technology with their permission. That's in some ways, people think that that's a little bit of a dichotomy. I'm enabling people to do things without technology, even though I'm such a proponent of technology. And I don't know, I feel like sometimes we get a little too caught up on, you know, on the specifics, and we lose track of the people. I am an amateur extra, but I'll admit something that people are going to judge me for more. I studied for my extra exam for about 4 hours before I took the test. I basically memorized the test questions. Now I can pass it now on my own merits. I actually understand the stuff well enough now that I can make it through the exam. I don't think I want to try to teach it, but I've got HF radios back there in the corner. I participate in field day. I help out with a lot of the stuff, but I honestly don't think I would have actually learned any of that stuff if I hadn't had my extra and had the option of doing it. Now, in my case, I also had a lot of Elmers to rely on. I had some good clubs, some good groups in the neighborhood, you know, in the area, and people who were willing to teach me. And I didn't just go off and try to do it myself when I didn't understand what I was doing. You know, I took the time to research it more. But I did take the approach of get through the test first and then learn the material. And for me, that worked very well. And I know a lot of other people that that's worked for as well. I do also know some people who have crammed through, passed their tech, and never gone anywhere. But I also know people who've taken the time to study, understood the stuff, passed their tech, and never gone anywhere. And I know I've seen people on all parts of the spectrum, and I'm not sure that I would say that, based on my experience, that there's any necessarily higher or lower likelihood that somebody is going to really get involved in ham radio and help the community, just purely based on how they decided to do that. Right. Do you need to learn the material? Absolutely. And Ham Study has the explanations there because you need to be able to understand that. And you can actually, a lot of people underestimate how much information there is in those. But at the same time, I'm not convinced that you necessarily have to do it before you pass the exams. To me, the exam is, as much as anything, a way of proving that you're actually serious enough about getting into the hobby that you're willing to do the work to pass the exam.
Yeah,
you can understand the material and fail the exam, and right. You can pass the exam without understanding the material. They're not mutually exclusive, but they're not mutually tied together. I mean, they're both things that you need to do. I'm a believer in the way that the VE system works. I'm a believer that we should have good exams. One of the things that's always bugged me the most, and the reason that I created Exam Tools as well as just Ham Study, And the reason that I do the antennas that you're talking about, which is not actually under the ham study name, it's under signal stuff. But the reason I do all of that is because technology should be able to help us with all of this stuff. It's like we're ham radio operators. We're technologically savvy. We are all about technology and appropriate use of technology. It doesn't mean it always has to be the newest technology, but it should be the best technology for the job that we're doing. And yet most of the exam sessions in the nation, and this will get me hate mail too, if anybody is, you know, not too lazy to send it, most of the exam sessions in the nation still print out probably 3 or 4 exams from each pool and use that for 4 years and give it on paper. And most of the VECs are perfectly happy with that. And it's only been in the last couple of years, even though I've been literally trying to do this for 10 years, I finally started to get some serious interest from W5YI and Laurel, and parts of GLARG have been interested. I still haven't been able to get to sit down and talk to anybody from ARRL, although I did have a nice conversation with Tom Gallagher at Dayton last year, but wasn't able to quite get that through to anything that we could really talk about in there. It's like, I mean, I've got technology that you can give every single applicant a completely unique exam. And I think that we should have that level of integrity in our tests. But at the same time, I'm not saying that I think that everybody has to pass it the same way. I think everybody should find what works for them. And I think that we should stop judging everybody else on how they do it so much and just get on with a hobby.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's interesting as you went through it. I think technician is so different than extra or general. You know, technician is get the ticket, get in. And then you know, I think most people learn from that point forward. And I think a lot of people see, I mean, including myself, I see extra as I have been learning and now I've got this and now I can, you know, take a test and pass it and get a certificate to say, yes, I did learn it. And now I'm, you know, qualified for that. And so it's like a different side of, you know, technician is get there and extra is, yes, I've made it. And I've struggled with, you know, mostly for me, it's struggled with the time, the amount of time. And, you know, you're awesome lucky you're able to sit down and for a short time study. It's not the way my brain works. I've every once in a while I pick it up and I'll put it down. I'll pick it up and I'll put it down. I've had to go and get an updated set of books because my 2016 books expired. And, you know, I'll get there eventually. And, you know, it's the same thing for me. I think a lot of my PC, you know, computer networking experience lets me be, you know, I'm the technical guy at field day because mostly that technical stuff is plug it in. Does it work? Is it connected? Are all the bits flowing in the right direction? Is all the electrons going the right way? You know, did the antenna get plugged in the analyzer the right way? Are all the things threaded right? Is there no cuts in the wire? When it comes to, you know, looking at the anything beyond the why is the SWR the wrong way, if it's not a technical thing, then yeah, I got to go ask somebody else. Because I don't get all 100% of the Smith charts. Someday I will.
But you know, I mean, that's the thing is ham radio is about learning.
Yeah.
Ham radio, I mean, the stated purpose is to enhance the technical expertise of people. I don't remember exactly how the pool is stated. Mm-hmm. But I mean, it's to help people advance the state of the communications and the radio art and all that stuff. Like written into the question pools is the assumption that people are learning as they go through there.
Right.
And if you look at it, you know, how much of the question pool do I actually have to understand to administer an exam? Like, why could somebody who's not even a ham not administer the exam?
Mm-hmm.
It's a little bit of an RHAP, rank hath its privileges, you know? Right. It's you put in a little bit of time, you show your dedication that you actually care enough about the art, about the hobby to get into this, and that gives you a little bit more. It doesn't necessarily mean that you understand all of that, but it means that you have enough interest that you're going to try, at least in general.
Yep.
And there's going to be exceptions to every rule, you know, and yes, there will be the occasional lid that managed to get their extra and never bothers to learn anything and messes up everybody's field day contest in part of the world because they're transmitting at full power and they don't know what they're doing and they're stomping all over everyone. And I mean, yes, stuff like that's going to happen. And sometimes it's because they're just idiots, and sometimes it's because they haven't been taught, and sometimes you're not sure you care, but it's all part of learning. I mean, it's a community, it's a hobby, and we should all be in this together. Like, who cares all of the details? Let's just figure out how we can how can we make this hobby better, and how can we do more with it? And that's what we should all be about.
And it looks like I'm gonna pull up your site now. It looks like you spent a lot of time doing that and caring and making it work. So this is hamstudy.com, .org, the website, and you know, you got your whole thing, and I'm logged in here, and hopefully it won't show my progress along the way.
Depends on which link to click on.
Yeah, I'm only a short bit into it. It is, you know, I looked through it, I've played with it, like I said. It is super friendly. I love the, and I'll go in there, and I don't care that I'm not doing so well. I've only had a certain amount of time. I got three kids like you and a job and all these other things, and Boy Scouts just to keep me busy all the time. I've seen some percent, about 10%, and my aptitude's better in some areas and worse in the others. And we talked about that, right? You know, you get bits and you don't get other parts, right? I don't know what, I can't remember what the E0 was, right? It's probably like safety or rules. I'm really good with those things, and some of the electronic stuff, you know, maybe not so much. But I really like the way this is presented. And like you said, you know, you've got different ways to do that. And I think that that's brilliant. You know, the fact that you give people the opportunity that they can go take the test. And a lot of people just say, well, you know, just take the test until you can get to that percent. That's not the kind of thing that works for me. The flashcards, and then again, my daughter, the youngest one, Lila, said, oh, that's great. The flashcards, I think that's going to really work. So I can look at it and see, and the parts that I don't get, I could read, and there's the information on there, and that's perfect. And, I think that's really great. I don't know. Is there stuff on here that I should highlight? Other than the way it goes, you know, if you look through,
my real interest, of course, right now is in the mobile app that's been consuming all my waking moments.
So let us go there.
Okay.
I think I can make that happen. So the mobile app, and I wish I got to figure out how to do screen sharing in here so that I can get on. But you did. Oh, we're glary. What's going on here? Oh, going all the way up. Here is the mobile app on my iPad. And you can see all the same stuff. I'm doing better in some and not better in others. Tell us about this mobile app. How'd you get here?
So the real challenge with the mobile app, and the reason that it's taken so long, is when we did the current website, I was just getting started understanding how to really do things right for mobile. One of my goals has always been that I feel like there need to be good free tools. And yes, I realize the mobile app does actually cost $3.99. It's not free. But I didn't want that to be the only option that you have. Mm-hmm. And so the goal has always been that this will be the online version once I can get there. This will replace the online version. We want to have the same features online for free, and it will always be there. But a lot of people have said, you know, we really need a tool, just tap to get rid of that. That's part of the kind of the automated tutorial.
Mm-hmm.
We really wanted to be able to have a, you know, for people who need to be able to study offline, they're on a plane, they're in a rural area, there's not good internet, et cetera. They need to be able to have a tool that works offline. Unfortunately, that is a lot more work. I think I actually rewrote the statistics and question selection algorithms in this app about 4 times in order to get everything running fast enough to be really to not feel clunky on the mobile app.
Mm-hmm.
But then when it's on the website, it needs to be using the internet connection. It needs to be going, you know, directly to the site. Mm-hmm. That should be a little bit easier. But just with the resources and the time that I had, we needed to be able to get to have the app supporting itself a little bit better. We've been, of course, supported. We're sponsored by ICOM. ICOM has been great. And you know, actually, I don't think ICOM gets quite enough credit for a lot of the things that they do, because they really do a great job of trying to promote the hobby and support the hobby in a lot of ways that I think people don't realize. ICOM came to me. I didn't go to them and say, hey, will you sponsor us? they saw when we did a site redesign, and they saw that, hey, these guys really look like they know what they're doing. And they emailed me and said, hey, we'd like to sponsor you. Are you open to advertising possibilities? And, you know, to be honest, my first reaction, I emailed Ray back and I said, you know, I don't think I'm interested because I'm just not willing to compromise the integrity of my site by putting ads everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are some ham radio sites, I'm sure you've seen some of them, that just have ads plastered everywhere to the point that you almost can't see anything. And I do not want Hamstudy to ever be one of those.
Mm-hmm.
But he came back and he said, no, we don't need to be everywhere. We want it seen that we're helping. And we want to support you guys and help you guys go. And basically, their entire advertising on our site amounts to, on the website, a sponsored by ICOM logo. So ICOM's helped us out a lot. And we, of course, were supported by the antennas. But we needed something that we could, a way that the app can kind of support itself. It's got server costs. It's got, you know, a lot of things like that. And so we've spent about 2.5 years working on this new interface. And it's great. All of this stuff can update live from the internet. So if you've got an internet connection, it will download it. The explanations are there. If you tap explain, you can see these are the same explanations that are on the website, and it'll automatically download updates to those. If a new question pool comes out, you'll be able to download that. Or if an update to this question pool comes out. So the section you're at right now is the current read questions section.
Mm-hmm.
So just if you want to read them, and there's something new on here from the website. If you scroll all the way to the bottom, you'll see Quiz Me.
Mm-hmm.
So if you tap that, you'll actually go into the flash into study mode, and it is focused on just the screen that you were just seeing. So just E4A. And if you tap on the stats button in the top right corner again, you can see the I want to study custom.
Oh.
And that means it's using a custom deck. And we will be doing a lot more with that in the future, where you'll be able to really customize the study area that you want to be in. For now, just honestly, for you user experience reasons, you can only do it, you know, select a sub element at a time. Mm-hmm. But there's a few new things on here. The CRAM mode is new, of course.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that you'll notice in CRAM or Quiz mode is we're now sequential by default. And that's an option you can change. So instead of giving you a randomized order of the questions, it'll go through in pool order. They'll still use the same selection, so it's still going to, you know, to jump back and give you easier questions now and again. But that makes it a little easier to keep everything similar to what you've just been looking at.
Mm-hmm.
And the great thing about that is that means as you're going through and doing the initial learning, you're going to be able to relate the different questions to each other. But then after you've seen everything, if you want, you can tap the graph button in the top right corner again, and you can see the randomized questions
mm-hmm.
option right there. And if you turn that on, it will start randomizing the questions. You've got this, the CRAM mode, like you've just been showing, where you select what the difficulty is. And so the idea there is that you can just go through and very quickly say, okay, yeah, I know this one. I know this one. I know this one. I don't really understand that one. I kind of understand this one. And then when you go back to study mode, it's all going to work again. And so we've got a lot of really exciting, just tap the button again to. We need to get it so you can swipe those away. That's
well, it's hard for me because I'm trying to show it to the camera, so I can't actually see it. I keep looking at the screen there. But
no worries, you're just finding all the UI things that I need to write down. Make sure we fix. We're still doing a lot of updates. We released it night before last, and I released an update yesterday with the first bugs we found. You know, that's how software works. You just got to keep on it.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, just. Really exciting stuff here. It's the same algorithms, just slightly improved, that you know from the hamstudy.org website.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't need an internet connection. You can set it up to synchronize with your online account.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
one thing I will mention, if you decide to do that, is that the aptitude calculations in the new app are actually different. So your aptitude will not show up the same.
Uh-huh.
And that's because the website's aptitude is crap. Basically, it's leading people to study way more than they need to because it the aptitude is an aggregate of the last 10 times you've seen the question, and you really don't need to go back that far. To get 100%, you'd actually have to answer every question in the entire pool 10 times in a row correctly. On the website.
Well, that's good to know.
A little bit obsessive.
Right.
So this has been changed so it only looks at the last four for aptitude, which I think is a much more sane default. But we've also got some really exciting additional kind of statistics things that we're going to be working in here. It's just a question of we really need to get this app out so we can get some people seeing it, find out what problems people have and such before we get to Dayton.
And so you launched this 2 days ago, you said? 2 days ago? Three days ago?
Yep.
And you launched both for the Android and the iOS platform at the same time?
Yep. We launched on Play Store, Amazon Store, and the Mac iOS App Store.
Oh, is it in the Amazon Store? I tried to find it for my Kindle Fire, and I couldn't find it, but I'll look again.
When did you look?
About the same when you
I think the Kindle store took a little longer to approve it. So
uh-huh.
Probably yesterday morning was the earliest.
Oh yeah, it was the day. It was like Tuesday or so that I looked at it. I'll check it out.
Yeah, they seem to update pretty quickly now that we're on there. But the initial approval took a little longer than either of the other two, which was actually a little bit of a surprise. But we'll try to keep them up to date on all of those. And the cool thing about the way that we did this, where it's so portable in the way that it works.
Uh-huh.
Is that not only should we be able to get this working on the web so that we've got the free web version up to date with all of these features, but when I can find time, again, I should be able to release a Mac and a Windows version for standalone applications as well.
Oh, that's cool. That's
so
cool.
That's all planned. I'm not giving any kind of timeline guarantees because now I've got to finish getting everything else ready for Dayton.
Right.
It'll be coming. It'll be coming.
Right. It looks nice. You did a really awesome job with the AI. Is that you got somebody's package or did you guys develop this all? Or I don't know a lot about the smartphone programming or the iOS or whatever. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have two partners, Ray Bateman, KD7RMX, who is my brother.
One of my brothers. And Ben Leverage. KF7KGR, and they both actually work with me at GradeCam as well, and they're both pretty good at front-end stuff. I'm really more of a back-end guy, but we actually hired a designer to do the core on this. We've put a lot more time and money into this than it probably actually financially justifies, but it's something we really wanted to do, something we really cared about, and we have periodically actually done some sales on the antennas. So really, antennas are what made all of this possible. The signal stuff, antennas, and the sales for that. We'll be selling those at Dayton. We'll be selling at a slightly reduced rate. We'll be selling for $15 each.
Mm-hmm.
And just to break even on the costs for us to go to Dayton, I have to sell 500 antennas, which is probably not likely to happen. But, it's... We're not just doing this for money. We're doing this because it's something that we love to do and something we believe in. So, and that's the reason that I sell the antennas is to make things like that possible.
Uh-huh.
But we did hire a designer who did the initial layout for us of kind of the basic pages. We've had to adapt that. And we've spent a lot of time on the user experience. It's something that a lot of, especially ham radio applications, they get skimped on because it's the easiest place to skimp on. It's one of the hardest things to do well. But it's something that we really feel like it's very important to do well, because if the user experience is getting in your way, then it's going to make it harder to study.
Yeah, absolutely. So I pulled up the signal stuff. So the signal stuff antennas is really it sounds like, and I may couch this in the wrong way, this is your business to support your hobby of doing the hamstudy.org.
Pretty much.
In a way. Which I think is awesome.
If anybody ever wonders why we made a decision that we made, or why we don't do something that they think would be a really good business idea with signal stuff,
uh-huh.
It's because anytime I'm spending lots of time on antennas, I feel like I'm wasting time that I should be spending on ham study.
Sure.
I'm not in the manufacturing business. Uh-huh. We just happen to make really good antennas that work well. I'm in the business of improving the state of amateur radio study and examinations. And the antennas make that possible.
Uh-huh. How long have you guys been doing the antennas? Is it about the same amount of time?
I actually took over the antennas from the youth group where I, the youth amateur radio youth explorer post where I first met my wife, believe it or not.
Mm-hmm.
She's been licensed longer than I have. Originally they were just the standard stainless steel panel wire design. And we've just continued to improve them. We switched over to using nitinol. We found better ways to attach the pins and get it more reliable. We've changed adhesives. Really, I think if you were to take a sample at the same time of year, every year back for about 10 years, you'd find a different antenna every time. Because we are continually improving these. But I actually originally took it over simply because we didn't have enough people coming to our youth meetings. I was one of the advisors of the Explorer Post at this point. And so we couldn't keep the fundraiser open for the youth group, but there were still a lot of people who wanted the antennas. And so I said, well, maybe I'll do it. I'd taken over kind of the planning of it anyway. I said, well, I'll take it over and I'll do it as a fundraiser for ham study. And I had no idea how big it was going to grow. I mean, it keeps getting bigger. And it's been kind of shocking, to be honest. But I mean, they're fun little antennas. My favorite demo to do when people come up at a hamvention or something and they ask about it is I say, well, this is the super elastic signal stick. Wow, and I can do it then. I can't do it now.
Right.
That's the super elastic signal stick. And you can literally coil it in your pocket, coil it up, stick it in your pocket or in your jump kit.
Yep.
And then it just pops right back out. Dual band. We also have, and I laid them out so I'd have them, and now I can't find them. We also have some 220 versions.
Mm-hmm.
These work great on the Bridgecom 220 handhelds. We made about 500 of them last night, so we've been working hard to get some ready for Dayton, but looking at the
website, it looks like they've progressed over time. I have one of yours, and like I said, somewhere that I probably had for 6 or 7 years. Whenever it is you saw Norm Goodkin when you met him in person, and he probably bought a bunch from you then. He came back to one of the classes that we did, you know, the WVE, and said, hey, you know, we buy these to support this product because we love it. And you know, help offset the cost, and I bought one, and the one I have is BNC, and it's just the metal BNC connector that's crimped on with probably the mm-hmm. piano wire, and it works great.
Now that one's still going to be nitinol,
but
yeah, when we started 3D printing the connectors, I wonder if this will focus well enough to actually see it. Maybe, probably not.
Yeah, maybe not.
Anyway, you can kind of see. So this is the most current version. This is the type that you'd put on an ICOM.
Uh-huh.
You can see the little fold there in the side, and you can see that there's the kind of the clear above and the black below.
Uh-huh.
These are my glow-in-the-dark ones, and I don't make these real often because they don't sell all that well. But they're fun because you can see exactly how everything's held together. And that hole is actually this really demonstrates the purpose of that 3D-printed cap that I custom-designed and printed, which is just to hold the adhesive in the place where it's going to provide the most strength to the wire.
Mm-hmm.
And this has really, really helped with the strength. You can pull them pretty hard.
Wow.
And it's just gonna stay there. So, and we like to experiment with different things. Haven't seen a lot of good male-to-male SMA adapters.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't like the ones that had the spinny things on them. So I got some and I designed a sheath for it that we just do the same thing, just inject a little bit of epoxy to keep it still. So that's the newest thing I've been playing with, and we'll see how people like that, if it's worth continuing or not. But that keeps me sane between programming projects, to just play with things like that, I guess. I can't quite leave well enough alone. I think the next thing we'll do is we're looking at increasing the diameter of the wire using slightly thicker wire, which will make it a little more rigid and less prone to kind of oscillating
mm-hmm.
to the point that it interferes with your signal, which is obviously a danger of any whip antenna.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but will you still be able to tie them in a knot?
You will still be able to tie them in a knot. That's kind of one of our trademark things that you have to do. That and the glow-in-the-dark tip. All of our antennas have a glow-in-the-dark tip.
Did they always? Because I think the one I got years and years ago may not have.
Yours probably didn't, because that's before I started doing 3D printing. But in fact, what yours probably has is it's probably got a hot glue, a dab of hot glue on the tip.
That sounds right.
Dipped in Plastidip. That's how I used to do them.
Got it, got it. So you don't poke your eye out, or at least you don't poke it too bad.
Right, right.
Right. Very cool, very cool. So you're going to Dayton, and you're launching the mobile product. Have you shown at Dayton before? Do you bring boxes of stuff, antennas and whatever to have done in the past, or is this first?
So I attended last year with John Jacobs, who runs I can't remember the name
of Radio 2.0. His is Field Radio. He was my last guest.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So John's doing some cool stuff there. And he used to, well, so he had a booth last year where he was doing some little portable stuff that he was building. Mm-hmm. And he invited me along to sell antennas. And so we did that. I was selling them at full price that year. And we kind of ended up in a booth that was out in the tents, and it wasn't real visible. But it was a great chance that it let me kind of walk around and talk to people about ham study and meet some people that I'd wanted to meet, including Tom Gallagher, and just kind of get a feel for how useful it would be to the ham study initiatives to present there. And we decided it was probably worth coming back. And so this year we're kind of going all out. John kindly let me take his booth, and we're moving. We're now going to be in building one on booth 1901 and 1902. So we'll have a lot better presence. We're planning out a new feature for the Ham Study app, which will actually be a game, which, assuming we can get it done, we'll probably have some contests going on with some prizes and stuff. Prizes may be primarily things like coupons for the app and free antennas or discounted antennas, because I've already spent all my money on plane tickets, but you know, I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Also, for any of your users who would be interested in our antennas, I created a coupon code for them that's good through the end of this month, the end of May 2018. If they use the coupon HAMRADIONOW, all lowercase, that will give them $1 off of their order and free shipping.
Cool.
So this is kind of a thank you for letting me on your show, and a hidden perk for anyone who watches the show and wants an antenna, to support what we're doing.
That's super cool. I really appreciate that, and I will I'll make sure that when I post it up on the website and in the Facebook groups and in the comments, I'll put that on there, and I'll let everybody know it expires on May 31st, and hopefully we can help support this great product.
I appreciate it.
So, when I looked at, I'm going to pull this up here because I think this is awesome. When I looked at your QRZ page, a lot of ham history in your family there. Mom, dad, grandfather, and grandmother, plus your brothers, your wife.
Both my dad's parents. So if you're going to talk about family, this is probably what you need to go. Go back to the Signal Stuff website.
Okay. Real quick. Okay, wait, I've got to be on the right screen here. Yeah.
Scroll down.
Okay.
Click on, no, not that far down. Okay, click on, where is it? It's going to be.
I'm not on
about,
the.
Oh, history, the antenna history. There you go. Scroll down a little bit to pages, and there's antenna history. Signal sticks history.
Oh, there we go.
Tells a little bit about, you know, some of the history that I just talked about. But scroll down a little further, and there's a link.
I met my wife then.
Click on that link.
Okay.
So this is actually one of the wedding announcements that we sent out. Only to certain people, of course.
Okay.
But yeah, so as you can see, we both come from active ham radio families.
No, that's totally cool.
And if you look carefully, there is a signal stick in the right middle picture where I am romantically offering her own FT60, actually. I didn't have an FT60 at the time.
Very cool.
But anyway, so yes, lots of people doing ham radio. I think we had something like 25 family members who were ham radio operators there at the wedding. And somewhere I've got a picture of all of them, but I haven't been able to find it for a while. I need to dig it out.
That, oops, there we go. We bring it back there. That's great. You know, the good kins that we talked about earlier, they call it they're a hamily, because everybody, you know, all of his kids are extras, and all of their kids, I think, at least are technicians and more. And then, you know, all of the cascading relatives out. And in my house, there's 7 people live here in my house with me, and all but my mom. My mom and dad live with us. My dad has his ticket after I did. My wife has her ticket. All 3 of my children have their tickets. So it's, you know, it's a ham family. I don't think we'll ever quite get to this level of wedding announcement, but it's it's kind of cool.
Well, you got to get the other family involved for that one, but it was fun. But yeah, so when I got licensed, my grandfather was licensed in 1948. He actually was instrumental in putting up the first Civil Air Patrol repeater in the nation, in formulating some of the CB radio rules. He's just done a lot of great things in his life. Russ Bateman, K7SG, and he's still with us, which is awesome. Still learning from him. And then my father got his license in 1976. And so when I got my license, he hadn't done as much with it, but I kind of got him active again. And then my mom got her license. And then, anyway, long story short, my older brother and his wife are licensed. My older sister is not. She's the only of my siblings who's not licensed. Both of my younger sisters are licensed, and one of them, her husband, is licensed. And both of my brothers are licensed.
Everybody a little bit active? Are there folks that
Varying degrees. Varying my sisters degrees. Don't use it much. My older brother gets on now and again, and often helps with antenna building. My younger brother is Ray, who actually has been very instrumental as one of my partners in doing the Ham Study app. Mm-hmm. Just kind of varying levels. We used to actually help out with a lot of service events, you know, parades and races and stuff like that, and we'd kind of do that as a family. And since, you know, with 6 kids in the family, and 5 of us licensed with my parents, we would sometimes help out with an entire, like a half marathon or something, just with our family, because that's all we had, all we could contact in time to get it done that were available. So it was a lot of fun. So sometimes we use it more on like family trips and stuff, but not all of them are super active. Probably none of them is as active as I am, but still a lot of fun.
Yeah. It is a lot of fun. We do a lot of the same stuff. My kids, my dad and I have and all 3 of my children have worked like Baker to Vegas race and some of the other races that they do around here. At least one. Some of them, thinking 5 times as of last year. And you know, AC 100 ultra marathons and stuff like that. We do a lot of stuff. It is very cool. Have we missed anything? Have we covered all the stuff?
I suspect we could keep talking about ham radio for the rest of the day. So I don't know.
Yes, we probably could.
You wanted to talk about?
We probably could. No, I think we covered it. Again, I love the product. I think this is awesome. I hope you a ton of success with the mobile app. I think it's really cool. And you know, like I got the both of the versions. I purchased the Android one before you sent me the link for the other. And thank you for that very much. At least one
can't
of
be
my
doing kids. Too bad. Somebody just sent me a text, a picture of a screenshot. So it looks like we are number 50 on the top paid education apps on the iOS App Store. So that's kind of cool.
That is totally cool.
The analytics still say that like 30 people have installed it. I think they're way like really slow updating. This is a part of any app release process, by the way, because you're like, people like it. Will they use it? Will people want to use it? And you're like, I have to wait for like 3 days to find out what people are doing now.
Yeah. I'll tell you, as a podcaster, it's kind of the same thing. You know, this will get posted up later this afternoon or this evening, and I'll slowly watch the, you know, the number of clicks, and then I'll watch Libsyn for the number of downloads, and then I'll get some comments here and there, and yeah, it's the same thing. I don't know. You know, I know some of them go bigger than others, and some of them not so much, and you just keep doing it. I'm just going to keep doing it.
Somebody tells me to go. You put stuff out there, you do the best you can, and you hope that people find it useful.
I assume it's like you. You know, I love this hobby, and I think it's valuable, and you know, some of it's for hobby for me, and there's a lot of community service, and
I think that's worthy, and I have I get a lot out of it, and so I'll keep doing it until I'm not there. But right now I'm having a good time.
Well, great. That's what the hobby needs. So thanks for doing what you're doing.
Yep. And thank you too. So I'm gonna do my little pitch here. So I'll pitch for you, or you know, you pitch for you. Go tell people where to find you.
All right. Well, hamstudy.org is where our website is. You can support us by buying antennas from signalstuff.com. On the hamstudy.org website, there's a buy the app button on the right corner that you can, on the top right corner that you can find if you'd like to try out the mobile app. And, you know, just remember our goal here is just to help people study. Our goal here is to provide technology that will help you study more effectively. So you're not just taking practice tests, you're able to focus your study and you're able to learn the material with those explanations and stuff. But at the same time, use what works for you. You don't have to buy the app. You can use the online website for free. It works on your mobile phone as well. And if you find another app that works better for you, then use that. The important thing is that we all learn, we all grow. And thank you guys for your support.
Cool. And so here's my pitch. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. It's I enjoy it. It's a lot of fun. It's free for you to watch, but it's not free for me to make. So if you like what we're doing, you want to support us, please visit hamradionow.tv and find Arvin. He's our chief financial officer, and click the pig and send me some love. Help me out. Help me make this happen. Send us comments. If there's something that you want us to cover, there's a great idea out there, something I haven't seen or haven't made it to my list of shows that I need to do, please send that to me as well. And help support us and help support the most important podcast or a video show on the internet. That's our tagline. I'm working on that one. Anyhow, my guest today has been Richard Bateman, KD7BBC. If you're going to Dayton, please stop by and visit him. Buy one of his antennas, get his app if you're studying for your general or extra, or if you've got a family member that wants to become a technician, put that in front of them and hopefully that will help them along their way. I don't know if you've ever seen the show before, and it's okay either way. We always end it the same way, and it's bad radio practice, so you might get it or you might not. I will say the first two words, and I will let you try to jump in with the last one. So thank you for joining us. This has been Ham Radio Now, episode number 397, hamstudy.org, over... and
out.
Awesome. You got that part. Now I'm supposed to do this. Ta-da. And now I'll clear it away. And now comes the best part of the show. That's the show. This is the after part of the show. Usually it doesn't hit the cutting room floor. This is usually about half of the time. We will go another half an hour and don't feel like you have to. I actually got some stuff I've got to do, but this is where the cool stuff hits the road. I don't know. Maybe not. This was really cool. I love this. My daughter was like, can you wait and do this later in the day? Cause I want to stick my head in here and say how awesome this is. And I'm like, I can't, cause you don't get home from school until 4 o'clock and I got stuff I got to do this evening, but you can come watch it afterwards. She kept showing me, she kept all day. Yesterday I got home from work. She's like, oh, I want to show you something else about this. Oh, I want to show you about that. Oh, I did this and I'm getting through it. And some of it I get, some of it I don't, but when I don't get it, I can read the flashcard. That's so awesome. So you're doing it.
If she has any suggestions, if there's anything that seems to, she gets like a hang up or something,
yep,
let me know. That's the kind of feedback we need. But, it's always nice to hear that something we've spent so much time on is helping. Cause it literally my friend Ben and I started, like, we discussed and we figured out that, you know, I can't do this one by myself. This is just, it's too much work to do what we want to do. I need somebody who can help, especially with the front end UI stuff. I can figure it out. It just takes me too long. I'll be 10 years. So we said, okay, we're starting, and we got going at the beginning of 2016, like January 1st. And we've been working on it since then. And we'll have weeks where we get a lot done, and then we'll have a couple months where things are so slammed at work because we work for the same place, and we're actually the team leads for the two different development teams. And so, you know, we'll go for a few months where we just can hardly do anything. And then we'll hit it hard again, and we'll just back and forth. And this last year, we just decided, you know what, we need to finish this, and we need to show it at Dayton. So that's our goal. We have to have it out by Dayton. To have it out by Dayton, it's got to be released by May 1st. To have it released by May 1st, we've got to get it in beta 2 weeks at least before that, preferably by April 1st, which we didn't manage. And so, I mean, we've just been... Yeah, I went for a couple of weeks where my kids almost didn't see me. They saw me for a couple minutes in the morning, and that was it. And it just feels so wonderful to have that out. And so then to see, you know, to see that it's actually, you know, people are liking it. You know, when you've spent so much of yourself, so much of your time and energy and money and just everything on that. And then you, somebody sends you a screenshot and you say, hey, I'm number 50 on the education top paid apps. And you're like, wow, that is, I mean, have any amateur radio app as a number 50.
Yeah.
I'm sure that's not going to last. I mean, that's the initial,
you never know.
It's the initial push, and you know, a lot more people are buying it right now than will normally be. I hope it'll do well over time, but I don't think, I mean, amateur radio is a small enough niche. I don't expect it to stay that kind of level, but even to just hit that, even during the initial rush,
right,
is exhilarating.
Well, and that's the thing, you know, I'll put this out and it'll hit several thousand users through their RSS feeds and then the website that people get it. And I usually wrap these up and put them on Facebook. There's a big group in our Facebook group as well. And you might see a little bump, I hope. And then, you know, you hit Dayton and hopefully you'll see another bump there. And then, you know, you see where it goes. I think the thing that's cool is, you know, Elmers across the country, like Norm Goodkin and like, you know, the guys that do your VE session, they see these products and they'll say, here's a good product. This is the one that I recommended because I like the whole flashcard thing. And the whole, you know, you get the every time I look at the extra book, and I just got the updated ARL extra book, because the one I had, I realized when I went to pick it up, it was expired. And that tells you how long I've been trying along the way. It's just so hard to have all these things to do. It's, you know, it's that thick. There's a lot of stuff in there, and you know, I'll be 51 tomorrow, and it's hard to keep stuff in this brain for so long. And I'll get through a certain section, and I know there's certain sections like I don't need to study the rules. I don't need to study the safety. That stuff is just stuff that comes natural to me. It's all the Smith charts and the reactance and resistance and all that stuff. That's just like, it's get it held on and I'll figure it out.
Yeah.
And I think mostly I want to get my extra so I can give back to be a VEC and to be able to help with, because all I can do right now is help with the tech tests. And when we do the 1 day classes, it's fine, but there's often a general or an extra that come in and, or a tech or a general that come to upgrade. And I can't grade their tests and I can't do whatever. All I can do is proctor the room at the most. And yeah, it's valuable, but I want to be able to do more.
Well, so one thing to keep in mind with that, you can miss up to 13 questions on the amateur extra exam.
Yep.
And still pass. So, you know, for example, one of the sections that you were having trouble with was, sublumen E5, mm-hmm. which is electrical principles, and that's where it's getting into resonance and Q and all that stuff. So that's all pretty complicated stuff, but there's only 4 questions of that are going to make it on your exam. So if you have to, you can decide, hey, this sublumen is just too crazy for me, mm-hmm. and I'm just going to set that one aside and study the other ones. And I mean, you don't want to do that too much, but that is completely you can do that. You know, a lot of people I've talked to, you know, helping them get into the technician exam are worried about the math.
Mm-hmm.
Now I don't think there's anything in the technician exam that I can't do in my head. So it's not particularly difficult math, but if you don't have any kind of a math background, and mine's only fairly light, but if you don't have any at all, I can see how it's kind of scary. But the thing is, you will have at most 2 math questions on a technician exam, and you can miss 9 questions.
Right.
So I just tell them, if you can't figure out the math, don't worry about the math. Mm-hmm. If you end up eating the math, you can learn the math then. And it's good to understand that the math is there. It's good to understand that, math exists to figure these things out. But get the ticket and learn.
Right. And how many hams use that math in their general, regular ham radio life? Every once in a while.
Well, the stuff on the technician, probably a lot of them. But well, the stuff on some of the other ones, probably not so much.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Well, I will... That's actually a good point. Every once in a while, I think, yeah, maybe I should focus more in some areas and not so much in others. And I know I probably should just sit down every once in a while and just go in and see what happens and take it. I did the last time that it expired was like 2016.
Yeah, it changed in 2016
when the extra expired.
A new pool came out in 2016.
I think it was then. I don't think it
was. I can show you exactly what changed if you want.
No, I'm just going to relate a story which will not paint me in the best light, but and it may have even been 2012 when it changed. Anyways, the last times it changed, again, you know, my awesome Elmer said, "Oh, just come and take it, and you know, you never know, and you've been studying whatever." And Naomi came back with a really sad face, and she's like, "I need to check the booklet that you took the test on just to make sure if you really did that bad." And I was like, "Oh no, I'm sure I really did that bad." I got half of them. She's like, "Oh, that's about the number, and that's what I was worried about." I'm like, "Yeah, I just didn't, you know, I'm just coming in to see what I can do, and it's all good, and I will make it there eventually."
You know, another thing to check, especially if you study using the app, or I mean, it's not quite as advanced on the website, but it's still there. When you finish the exam, it'll show you a bar graph. Mm-hmm. And that graph is where you missed the most questions. Because
right.
Keep in mind, it doesn't matter what percentage you got of a sub-element. It matters how many questions you missed. And those are the sub-elements that are hurting you the worst. And on the new app, there's actually a button that will say study weakest. Uh-huh. So after you take the practice test, you hit the study weakest button, and it'll take you to the flashcards. The flashcards will be focused on the sub-element or sub-elements where you missed the most questions. So, you know, you spend like a half an hour working on that, you take the test again, just keep doing that. And each time you're just going to get a little closer on the areas where you're the weakest at. And of course, if you decide, hey, this sub-element I just can't handle, you can set that one aside and just work on the other ones.
Yeah. I keep telling myself what I got to figure out how to do is, you know, we do monthly session when we have our Aries. I'm involved in Aries down here, and our Aries on our first Saturday of the month morning. And we got to do is figure out just a way to like take the week off before one of those and just sit and just do this without doing anything else over and over and over and read the book and whatever.
The app is designed so you can do it just a little bit at a time, you know, pull it out when you can. And you'd be surprised how fast you can make it through there if you just do a little bit at a time. I'm serious. Yeah.
The problem for me is the just remembering the what I got. You know, for the ones I get, and usually, you know, like there's some that I get and I know, and I'll click it and yes, I got it right. But then there's the ones that I don't get for whatever reason. I haven't been exposed to that information or whatever. And those are the ones like I may go back and see it like 2 weeks later and I'm like, yeah, okay, I did it and I have no idea.
The study mode will take that into account.
Yeah.
It'll just keep giving it back to you. Because, you know, even if you do that for 2 months,
right,
eventually you're going to start getting it.
Yep.
Even if it's just because you hate the question so much that you remember which one the right answer was, just so it'll go away.
Right.
You will get it.
Well, I think that's the cool thing. I'm like, okay, got it wrong. I know I'm going to see it a little bit later down the road. Oh, there it is again. Oh, I got it wrong. I'll see it a little bit later. Oh, I got it right this time. I'm not going to see that one again. And I think that reinforcement is awesome.
Well, and that'll be true initially, but once you've seen everything, it'll actually... It's a pretty complex algorithm, but suffice it to say that if you've seen something 10 times and gotten it wrong, like 9 of those times, and you got it right the last time, it still sees that as being a harder question than if you just got it wrong or just got it right one time. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it takes into account how many times you've seen it as well as all the other different things. So the more you struggle with it, the harder time you have getting it right, the more often it will appear until that's no longer the case.
Right. And I think that was the part in the sections that I've made it through. That's the part where it's helping. All right. Well, very cool. I gotta run off and do my day job. And
I gotta go track down some sprinklers.
Cool.
The pain of my existence.
Yeah. Well, we've zero escaped here, so I don't have to worry about that anymore. Thank you so much for spending some time with me today. And I'll post this up, and hopefully I drive some sales to you. And good luck at Dayton.
All right. Thanks, David.
Yep,
send me an email when you get it posted so I can take a look.
You got it. 7-3.
All right. See ya. 7-3. Bye.
Okay. Well, thanks for joining me. Oop, there's a blackout. And another episode coming soon. If you made it all the way to the end, thanks for your support and hanging in there with me. And hope it's more than Gary. Bye-bye.